Gary Talbot is the Assistant General Manager for the System-Wide Accessibility with the MBTA. Before joining the MBTA in 2007, Talbot served as a Senior Engineer for Walt Disney World Ride and Show Engineering. In 2004, Talbot developed the Disney Ride and Attraction Accessibility Audit Forms and Process. Talbot, who holds a degree in medical engineering from the University of Michigan, is active in various trades and civic organizations. From 1996 to 2009, Talbot was the chair of the Society of Automotive Engineers Adaptive Devices Standards Committee, which has responsibility for developing technical standards for adaptive devices used in personal use vehicles by people with disabilities. Talbot has presented at many conferences, conventions, and benefits of universal design and compliance with ADA, other accessibility-related federal, state, and local codes. So please welcome Gary Talbot.
Well, thank you very much. Again, my name's Gary Talbot. This is really quite an honor, and I really appreciate Dr. Huber inviting me to speak to you this morning. As it was said, and thank you very much, Robin, for the introduction. I feel like a gypsy at this point in my life. Really, an automotive engineer, focused primarily on personal use transportation. But then, with my years at Disney, had a chance to really get into mass transportation. If anybody's ever been there, both coasts have monorails, fixed route bus, boat systems, cruise ships. So I had a pretty cool job when you factor in transportation and everything else, and then came here in May of 2007 to the MBTA. So what I'd like to talk to you about today is kind of a past, present, future look at transportation, and I really think that this is a presentation that you could almost slam dunk on any transit agency in the nation. The only big difference would be, have they been sued or not? And I'll talk about that in a minute. But I think the introduction was really a good one, because I'll take you through just a little bit of the legislative history and try and make a point that while laws are wonderful and laws are great, they're really great when they're followed, not so great when they're not followed. So with that, we'll touch on a history of accessibility legislation, and this is really with the focus on Title II. Title II Part B is transportation, and that's out of the ADA, and I'll speak about that a little bit more. What happens when you don't follow the law? Well, we had a class action lawsuit. It's actually one of the largest in U.S. history. 49-page document. It's on MBTA.com if you'd like to see it. And while 49 pages isn't that large, if you get a chance, look at the settlement agreement. It's an amazingly complex and specific document saying what the MBTA will do. Some of the key settlement commitments, including my position. My position was created as a result of the class action lawsuit and the settlement. And then moving forward, where do we see the T in the years to come? Whoops, I'm sorry, let me back up. Okay, now, back to legislation for a second. If you look at where did all this start? Well, Congress in 1958, there was a call for voluntary standards for design of accessible buildings. So this was like the first time that Congress and the federal government said, you know, maybe we ought to do something around accessibility. If all of our courthouses, all of our post offices, if everything has a set of stairs leading to it, and it was very focused on physical disabilities, we probably ought to do something about it. In 1961, the ANSI guidelines came out. Those were the first guidelines, and they were the first scientifically developed guidelines that addressed primarily physical accessibility. In 1965, the Rehab Act amendment, this was the National Commission on Architectural Barriers, was established, and this was in 1965. In 1968, the Architectural Barriers Act was passed, and with the passing of the Architectural Barriers Act, you for the first time had a barrier removal section for federal buildings. And what barrier removal means, imagine a courthouse that has nothing but steps leading to it. There's no accessible entrance. Barrier removal says you got to go out there and you have to do something. You have a certain amount of time. You have to remove those barriers. If we go, I apologize. Okay, and then as Dr. Huber mentioned, 1973, the Rehabilitation Act was passed, Section 504. These were design standards. It was enforcement for federal fund recipients. That's critical because for the first time now, we're starting to match up the federal funding and federal dollars to what that facility needs to look like. So in the past, prior years, nothing was tied to funding. Now for the first time, the federal government said, okay, if we give you money and you're going to go out and you're going to build something, you're going to have to follow these design standards. And this was the first official focus on transportation access. So for the first time, we see an expansion where we go from maybe the physical building or what we call the built environment. We're now looking at transportation as well. But there were a lot of holes in Section 504. Section 504, if you have a moment, Google it. Very short document, beautiful words. People with disabilities shall be able to use, benefit. Things have to be accessible. It's just really, really good language. But a ton of holes. And as was mentioned earlier, there was really no focus on Title I of the ADA, which is employment. And there were a bunch of other holes. And that's really what the Americans with Disabilities Act did. It was the stitching that took all the holes of Section 504 and laid out everything and said, well, if you do these things, people with disabilities for the first time will be guaranteed an opportunity to really get a full bite at the apple, to really be able to participate and benefit from American society and our way of life. It includes access to all modes of MBTA transportation, if we focus back to the T. Bus, rail, boat, everything. And again, think back to Section 504, which started the federal funding stream requirements. The ADA followed on that, and now anything that's public transportation that falls into that Title II, that's covered as well. Well, as I stated earlier, what happens when you don't follow the rules that have been out there since 58, 61, 65, 68, 73? Oh my God, 1990, we still weren't doing it. We got one of the largest lawsuits in U.S. history. And thank God we settled on April 10th of 2006. And just a word or two about the plaintiffs. A few named plaintiffs and then the Boston Center of Independent Living. You'll see that a couple places in the document. That's what BCIL is. You know, a group of citizens that literally all they wanted to do is use public transportation. So imagine if you're from this area. I'm not. I'm from Ann Arbor, Michigan. If you're from here, you're born and raised here, or you moved here, and all you want to do is go to school, go to work, you know, go where you want to go with your friends and family and that type of thing, and benefit from public transportation. And now we're 35, 40 years into this struggle, and you still can't do it. That's what the lawsuit was about. I'm not going to read this, but I want to read the first sentence. Because here's this quasi-state agency, the MBTA, that for 40 years or so really ignored what was required, did very, very little, did some good things, but certainly not enough good things, and yet somehow they transformed in 2006 to say, this agreement is based on a shared vision between the plaintiffs and the MBTA to make the T a model transit system accessible to all. I mean, there couldn't be a bigger transformation. When I read this, when they contacted me and asked me to consider the job, and I read that, I thought, you know, if this isn't just smoke and mirrors and they're really serious about this, this could be pretty cool. And I can honestly say it's pretty cool. They were serious. The next slide. I apologize. I'm having a little clicker trouble. One of the, as I stated, one of the key settlement agreements was the creation of system-wide accessibility. And really, it was just my position. It was an assistant general manager position, reporting directly to the general manager. Why is that important? Well, you guys will learn as you go through your educations and you get out into the workplace. If you report to the top, if you are the top, or you report to the top, you can make things happen. That's why they put you in those positions. If you're lower in the organization and you see things that are wrong, you see things that need to be fixed, you need funding for certain things, it's very, very difficult to get that. And the plaintiffs knew that. So they wrote into the settlement agreement that my position would be created. I report directly to the top. That can't be changed. It's part of the settlement agreement. We can go through all kinds of reorganizations, and I have to report to the top of the organization. And it truly is an incredible benefit to be able to do that. What the general manager did that hired me is he allowed me to say, look, this isn't a one-person thing. We have to develop an organization for this. We've got way too much on our plate. And he allowed me to expand that settlement vision and create the Department of System-Wide Accessibility. That includes our reduced fare offices. That's where folks go for senior passes, the transportation access pass if you have a person with a disability, or you need to use paratransit, you need to pay money into your paratransit account. So I have two offices, one at Back Bay and one at Downtown Crossing. We really are a clearinghouse of information, subject matter expertise regarding access-related issues, projects, and initiatives. It's what we do. It's kind of our DNA. We developed a matrix system for tracking our settlement agreements. While we have a 49-page settlement, we have roughly about 240 specific settlement issues that we have to track. This is done all through the federal court system. And we're tasked to drive change where necessary throughout the T. So not only do we track the settlement agreement and maintain compliance to the settlement, but we're also charged to change the T. How do you really go beyond the settlement agreement and create the most accessible and inclusive public transportation system anywhere? If we look first, so when I got here, you kind of look at the system and you say, boy, you've got rail issues. And heavy rail is your subway cars. Light rail is like Green Line. You guys probably have been on the Green Line. That's a trolley car, so you board at the street in some locations. Heavy rail is all your subway stuff, your Orange Line, Blue Line, Red Line. You've got bus rapid transit, the Silver Line. You've got fixed route bus. You have commuter boat, commuter rail. The settlement focused on the heavy rail, light rail, and fixed route bus. That's what the settlement was about. So we had to start there. But when you look at light rail, heavy rail, and your fixed route bus system, the fixed route bus is the system that goes out into folks' neighborhoods. It's the one that's half a block from your house, a block from your house, sometimes right in front of your house is a bus stop. So it was the one that touches most folks. It's also the most heavily used in our system. So we started there. As of 2006, our bus fleet is 100% accessible. That's a good start. That means all of our high-floor buses that have lifts, they're in the second door of a 40-foot-long bus, they all have a lift. On the rest of them, a majority of our buses, we have about 1,000 buses, about 700 or so have low floors, and they have ramp-equipped buses. They're ramp-equipped buses, and they have a ramp at the front of the door. So that was done by 2006. Since the settlement, we've procured 310 new low-floor buses because the settlement agreement said that we had to get rid of the old high-floor buses with the outdated lifts, and it takes longer, it's more difficult. You can't independently access the bus. Driver has to go back, turn a key, let the lift out, things like that. Where on the ramp equipped, they just kneel the bus, drop the ramp, you roll up and in, and you're on the bus. Improve focus by bus operations and bus inspection and maintenance. One of the things the settlement said, okay, well, go out and buy the new buses. You already have buses here, but you're not taking care of things. So you have to put measures in place so that you're actually looking at things so that you better maintain what you own. And that was a huge issue for us. But when you get all this stuff done, think about this for a second. You've got all your buses done in 2006. They're all accessible. You're improving your maintenance on your buses. You're doing a much better job. Now the bus pulls up and things are working. People can get on and off. But now you can't get to the curb because people are illegally parked in the bus stop. And if you guys know Boston a whole lot better than I do, very, very tight streets, very congested, no parking anywhere. What do people do? Well, I'm just going into Dunkin' Donuts for a minute. I'm just running into the bank, or I'm just going to chance it. We had a system in Massachusetts where every local community set the fee for illegally parking in bus stops. And no other police department could write a ticket for illegally parking in a bus stop if they weren't from that town. So in other words, if you had, let's say, a Somerville, and you had an illegally parked vehicle in Somerville, and a Boston police officer saw that, they wouldn't be able to write a ticket because they're not a Somerville police officer. Now, our transit police officers, the MBTA, we have about 300 transit police officers, they could write a ticket, but they had to use their book. Well, we service 175 communities. That means we need about 175 ticket books. Guess how many tickets we wrote? Not very many. So one of the things we did is once we got our kind of house in order on the bus side, we're fixing them, we've got lift equipped, we've got ramp equipped, we need to get to the curb. Everything starts for us by getting to the curb. You don't want folks who are blind walking across an active roadway to try and get onto a bus. You don't want wheeled mobility users trying to get out into an active roadway to get on a bus. We've got to get to the curb. So we started an effort to change the legislation, and we wrote a bill, got it into the legislature, got support by Governor Patrick, and effective April 2009, we now have one price statewide. It's $100. Any ticket book can be used by any police officer throughout the state, and the $100 ticket can be written. We issued 1,536 tickets were issued from April 2009 when this was passed to December 2009. And prior to that, in 2008, we wrote 290 tickets the whole year. What it did was, and the police came to me and they said, Gary, if you'll support this and testify to state legislature and help us get this passed, we promise you that we will get out there and enforce this thing. And they've been amazing. It was one of those examples where it was just a clear hole that no one had really thought about. But heck, when your buses aren't accessible or if you're not fixing them, what does it matter if you don't get to the curb? The stuff's not going to work anyway. But this was a building block that we needed to do so that we could provide better and more compliant service. So, fixed route bus service. Now you got the buses fixed. Now they can get to the curb, at least theoretically. Boy, we had bus drivers that had been on the job for 15 years and had never had any training around how they win. How does a bus driver win? How do they know when they've done a really good job? They made it to the curb. Man or woman standing there says, can you kneel the bus for me? No, I'm not going to kneel the bus for you. You're not in a wheelchair. Wait a minute. Anybody can request that. When's the last time you provided that training to your workforce? We hadn't done it. So we developed a new recertification program, and one day was dedicated to accessibility. And we really did something the T has never done, and I don't know many transit agencies that have done it. It's something we actually did at Disney quite often. We did step-by-step procedures with scenarios built into the procedures. In other words, it's fine to lay out a procedure and tell the driver when you see someone at the bus stop, you pull over and you curb the bus. But what do you do if somebody still is illegally parked? Well, we want them to negotiate with the person and say, you know what, I can't get to the curb. Don't try and get out in the street. I'll meet you right down there. Just can you make it down the 35, 40, 50 foot down the sidewalk? I'll pull over and meet you there. So we built all that into our procedures, and then we looked at our training and developed training modules around those procedures. The bus operations folks loved it. The operators really, really liked it. The plaintiffs helped out with it. It's currently provided for all new hires. It's also provided for a return to work requirement or if it's a result of discipline. So anybody that goes out in the field and they have a problem today, they've already been through the training once, but if they have an issue, they get disciplined, then they go back through the training again. The first half of the day is kind of like this. It's classroom. PowerPoints, all the special orders, the procedures, here's how you do it, lots of pictures, lots of illustrations, things like that. The second half of the day is with five different wheeled mobility devices. We go out onto two different buses. We have high floor and low floor buses. And they actually get on the buses. They have to try and get up the ramp without using the curb in a manual wheelchair. Several of them will try it. Most of them can't even do it. So for them, it's for the first time they're starting to understand why folks with disabilities using a manual wheelchair will look at them kind of crazy when they just drop the ramp and say, get on the bus. It's not as easy as it looks. And then they have to practice putting the securements on so that they better understand by using a manual fixed frame wheelchair, a manual folding wheelchair, a power-based wheelchair that's very difficult to secure, and then two different kinds of scooters, a three-wheel scooter and a four-wheel scooter. The other thing we do on the scooters is we have them try and turn the scooters around on the bus. The reason we do that is because that's a manual steer device. It's got just a single shaft down to a wheel. And what does that do? That makes for a very large turning radius. So imagine the frustration on drivers when they have somebody come in forward in their bus in a scooter and say, okay, we'll turn around. And they're frustrated that this person's taking a lot of time. It's very hard for them to do that. Well, as soon as they jumped in the seat and tried it, they couldn't do it. What does that mean? Well, now it's easier for them to understand why they have to ask folks to move, put both of the flip-up seats on both sides up if possible, get folks out of the way a little bit to give folks a little bit more room. But it was the first time that they had ever had that opportunity. We're looking to develop similar programs and build off of this model for our newly formed MassDOT. MassDOT is the result of transportation reform. So last year, Governor Patrick signed into law the new Transportation Reform Act, which put all of transportation in Massachusetts under one umbrella. So now, even though MBTA is a quasi-state agency, we sit under the umbrella of MassDOT. So now we can take the success of trainings like this and say, you know, Mass Highway has issues we could help train with, and the Mass Turnpike, the folks that were working in the Turnpike that are now MassDOT, we can help them as well. So this was focused primarily, as I said, on bus. Start with bus, kind of come into the core system now. All right, how are you going to get in and out of the system? This chart shows you what this system was like just a few short years ago. This is elevator uptime. That means out of a 20-hour day, that's how many hours we operate, is 20 hours per day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Very seldom do we deviate from that. Well, what percentage of the time would people with disabilities be able to find an elevator working? And working at a very key station. Let's say like Harvard Square, you have one elevator. If that elevator's not working, you've got trouble. Well, look at 2003, 92% of the time, almost 93% of the time it worked. And that may sound like a high percentage, but think about it for a second. That means 7% of the time it's not working. So if you're going to school and you need to get off at Harvard, and they tell you you can't get off at Harvard, and you have to go to another station because the elevator's down, that's a really big problem. Look what happened in 2005. 28% of the time it worked. If you look at Park Street, such a critical station. Same thing, 2005, 44% of the time it was working. It was ridiculous. People couldn't even get from the street. 808 is the street elevator that takes you right down to the red line. You couldn't even get in to access the red line. So if you're going to school at Tufts, if you're going to school at Emerson, if you're going to the hospital or to your doctor or wherever you needed to go, you could not use that. 44% of the time it was working. So why was that the case? What we were doing then, prior to late 2005, the MBTA had a focus on, tell me when something's broke, I'll go fix it. Well, boy, from a customer service model, that's great. I'll tell you, there would be no better way to get less folks to go to Disney than to just fix the stuff when it breaks. Because when you go there to ride Buzz Lightyear or, you know, Rock and Roller Coaster or something like that, and all of a sudden, geez, I'm sorry, I blew a bearing, the ride's down. Folks wouldn't, they're not going to pay $110 a day for that experience. Disney knows it. So what do? They have a preventative maintenance strategy. That's what they do. They don't let things break. They know when things are going to break, and then you put things in place to prevent it from breaking. The T had never thought in those terms, and I wish I could take credit for this. It was not due to my input at all. They took this on themselves, and I think because of, it was Dan Grabowskis was our general manager at the time. It was his first day on the job, and he told me this story that there was a local radio station that did this expose on the T, and it was focused on elevators. And the next morning he came in and he got everybody in his office. It was his first full day in the job, and he said, we got to do something to fix this. Well, what they did is they completely tore up the contract and took a preventative maintenance view of the contract. They doubled it in price. It's now about a $10 million a year contract for us, so it's not short money, it's a lot of money. But it was so wonderful because the major emphasis was on maintaining elevators in good working order. So for the first time, we were paying folks to go out, look at the elevators, find out what's going to break, and get those parts in before it breaks, and then get the parts replaced so that you're down for maybe an 8-hour shift to fix the elevator versus it's down for, you know, 2 weeks waiting for parts and all these other things. And that's what the previous contract did. So we got our bus stuff done. We're focused now on fixing the elevators and keeping them working. We reduced the elevator repair and response time. Tremendous improvement. Now, just to give you an example of what this looks like, this is calendar year 2006. Again, elevator uptime. You can see what the impact of the new contract is having. It's certainly not a straight line, but you don't expect that when you're starting new things. If I add in the next year, I think. Okay, here's 2007. Now, look on the left is our scale. We're at 98%, and we're approaching 100%. And I will tell you that anything less than 100% for transportation is almost, unless you have redundancy where you have more than one elevator, it's still a problem. But we're so much better. I mean, look at the increase, and look at how we've steadied out. So you can tell from like June, July of 2007, we're really starting to understand the system better. If we bring in the next year, 2008, now we're really doing much better. This next slide, I want to make a point. Here, our scale is 88 to 100%, 12% on the left. The next chart is 1%. We now measure. Now, in March of this year, we actually got very, very close because we were actually at 99.2. They went back in and refined the numbers a little, and we were at 99% for that. But still, we can say for 2 years running, our scale is now in 1%. And we're averaging about 99.5, 99.6 over a year. And this is system-wide. What a transformation. So first we focused on bus, got those fixed. We can get them to the curb better than we ever were before. Now the stuff that we own, the vertical access equipment that we own, the elevators are working much, much better, and we're opening those stations up to people with disabilities. But you can't keep things running forever. You've got stuff in your system that is 25, 30, 35 years old that has to be replaced. So elevators just don't live forever. They have a lifespan. What are you going to do with that? Well, parallel to all these efforts, we had to put in an elevator replacement program. And what this is it kind of launched off the maintenance for the elevators. And it said, well, okay, when we identify those elevators that are older that need to come out, we better put a plan in place so that we can do that and do it before we just try and extend their life so much that they're not going to make it and our numbers are going to drop. So parallel, we've mapped out the entire system. We've identified the first 17 replacement elevators. But another key thing happened. We identified those 17 elevators, but what are you going to ask someone to fix? I mean, if you just pick up the phone and call the elevator guy and say, I want you to replace this elevator, guess what? They're going to give you something back that probably isn't going to last very long. Why? Well, they're in the business of selling elevators and fixing elevators. They don't have your best interests at heart. Well, at Disney and other corporations, what they do is they develop their own standards. They say, no, wait a minute, you're not going to give me just what you want to give me. I've got engineers and designers working on this too. I'm going to tell you how I want you to structure that elevator so I know I'm getting the best I can possibly get. So the MBTA, kind of parallel to this effort, developed its own elevator standard. And we're one of the few agencies in the nation that has their own elevator standard. It covers both new elevators, and then for a replacement elevator like these, you apply it to the maximum extent possible. So some things you won't get, but a lot of things you will get. And that'll make a long-term benefit. It'll be a wonderful long-term benefit because what you replace will last longer. Oops, sorry. In addition to the replacement elevators, we also said, well, what do we do like at Harvard? You only have one elevator. That elevator's not going to work 100% of the time every day. And it's such a key station. Don't you need a second elevator? So we also, part of the settlement agreement said, there are certain stations you're going to go out and you're going to put multiple elevators in, because people with disabilities shouldn't have to depend on just one working and always working. That's what this program is. If you look at Downtown Crossing, there's four elevators that'll be added there. Imagine this for a second. Anybody that knows Downtown Crossing, if you get off a red line or get off an orange line and you need to switch and just do a switch line to line, if you're ambulatory, you can stay in the paid area. So you get off the train, you stay in the paid area, you switch over to the other line, and you go. But if you're a person with a disability, you get to pay twice because there's no elevators to make those connections. There's only stairs. So this, for the first time, will allow us to do what we're legislatively required to do, which is not charge people with disabilities twice to do the same thing that ambulatory users do not have to pay twice for. So I argued until the elevators get in, we ought to just charge everybody twice. That didn't make it. But we are going to, that's going to be wonderful, and that'll be in the summer of 2014. So just a real quick graphic on the system. The little blue icons is the international symbol for accessibility. It's how we denote things that are accessible in the transportation world. You do it for bathrooms, you do it for a lot of things. This is what the system looked like in 1990. Now you can see that most of the south end of the orange line was all accessible. Look at the blue line. Look at the red line. Can you imagine trying to use this stuff? The green line, forget about it. You couldn't get on the cars. It was terrible. Now, if we fast forward to 2008, it's starting to look a lot better. Now, this green line map does not have all the stations on it. There's about 30 or so surface street, surface level stations today that are not accessible. But look at how much better we've gotten in 2008. Whoops. And then 2012, this is what we're projecting that the system will look like. Much better. Does not factor in commuter rail. It's a look at our heavy and light rail system. But just making the stations more accessible through vertical access, and that's what that previous chart meant to discuss and to display. So, and I should have said that. So that's really focused on elevator access. How many stations can I get into? And it's also some platform-related issues if it's like the green line. But what happens when I've got a big gap? Today, at many of our stations, we have huge horizontal and vertical gaps. So the doors open, you guys have probably seen it, doors open, you could have a 4 or 5 inch vertical gap and someone sitting in a wheeled mobility device, person who's blind, a person who's had a stroke, cane, crutches, walker, you know, that can be a daunting thing. You're sitting, well, what do I do now? I can't get off the car. So what we're doing today is we're evaluating all of our track alignments relative to the platforms. And we're bringing those back into design spec. The T did not have a good history of paying a lot of attention to that design requirement, even their own design requirement. It's more of an issue now. It's part of the settlement agreement. So we have to look at that. So the first thing you do is you set your track in place and you get that where you need it to be. Once the track and platform work is complete, or let me back up a sec. So once your track is where you need it to be, then you can look at your platform and say, well, it's called the top of rail measurement. Is that where it needs to be? Or does it need to be adjusted? Oftentimes, you'll need to grind down 2 inches, 3 inches. Maybe you need to add 2 or 3 inches. And imagine, these platforms for most of our heavy rail are 450 foot in length. And you can't just do a ribbon. You can't just do a short piece. You're usually talking 20 foot, 30 foot, 40 foot wide sections that are 450 foot in length. That's a football field and a half. But once that work is complete, then we can look to the rail cars. Because as a rail car runs on the rail, it wears the wheels. The bearings wear. The airbag suspension wears. All those elements wear. And then depending on the occupant load, if I'm at 50% load, 90% load, overload, that's going to change the elevation of the car, and that's going to change the gap. So this project is a multi-year initiative, multi-million dollars. Will require considerable resources from both the budget department and operations. So in the interim, we're trying to do this portable bridge plate program. I will tell you it's a disaster. I'm not a fan of it. We made bridge plates before I got there. We put them at every station. They're locked against the wall. And the idea is that a person with a disability could say, hey, I've had a bad gap at this station before. I'd like to use the bridge plate. Customer service agent or a train operator, motor person would go over, unlock it, put it down for you. You get on, you tell them where you're going. Somebody on the other end does the same thing, pulls it off the wall, puts it on the floor, you use it. I mean, in concept, it sounds great. The problem is, people with disabilities want to be independent. They don't want to go looking for a customer service agent. They've got to get to work like everybody else has to get to work. They have to get to class like everybody else. We don't have a lot of free manpower just floating around stations. You can't find people. So it's a very frustrating thing. It was something the plaintiffs were very, very key on. They pushed really hard for the T to do it. We've tried several things to improve it, and we'll continue to try that. The frustration is the GAP project is such a long project. People want something today, and they should. And so we're trying to make it better. It's just not a very, very good project. So that's kind of like the physical world. That's if you get the gaps in order, the trains are accessible, your elevators are working, the bus system can feed to your heavy rail and light rail system. But what about wayfinding? How in the world do you get yourself around the system? I didn't want to add too many slides to it, so I didn't put some of the examples in, but anybody that's been on our system knows one thing. There is more variations to signage in the MBTA than anywhere else on the planet. We actually have one of the original designs where the guy's pointing a finger telling you to go that way. It's just in one of our stations. I have a picture of it. It goes from that to different fonts, different font size, different brushstroke thickness. So people with vision impairments may or may not, well, where did that come from? With little tails on the T's and the J's and things like that. Totally non-compliant text, shouldn't even be there. But the point is, there's just variations everywhere. So what the plaintiffs did, this was near and dear to their heart. Many folks with disabilities really struggle with wayfinding issues. If things aren't clear and consistent, it's very hard for folks to navigate. So one of the things that we're doing is we're developing a complete new wayfinding system. We're developing a manual, an electronic tool, that will require us to go in and use pick lists and pull down menus to develop all of our signage in the future. It'll be clear and consistent, one size fits all. It'll be rolled out to the entire system. It will take many, many, many years to get this done. But the great news is we finally, thanks to the settlement agreement, we recognize that we have this huge issue and we're addressing it. We've done some prototype work. This is just a little background on our prototype work we did out at Alewife Station. And then we're trying to figure out the next station to do. And keep this in mind. Every time we pick a station and we're trying something, we move about 1.4 million people a day. Folks call you up. They email you. They send letters to the editor and stuff like that. What are these guys doing? So you can't just go out and just pick something and say, hey, I want to try something over here. Folks that have used the system for 20 years will get confused. They'll think that you just did something and their path of travel changed. So you have to be very, very careful how you roll things out. And again, back to the 20 hour per day, you don't get a lot of downtime. So another key element was future vehicle enhancements. Okay, well, that kind of takes care of where you are today, but are your vehicles as good as they can be? Are they as accessible as they can be? And the answer is clearly no, they're not. You may be able to roll on and get on, but right now today in all of our heavy rail cars, the leaves of our doors, we have two leaves and they're pocket doors. The leaves themselves are less than 32 inches wide. Well, what happens? Well, if only one of them opens, a person using wheeled mobility can't get on or can't get off. That means now in rush hour, they're struggling to get through a mass of people to get to another door. So that was just one example of one of the things that we've done is we took the elevator design requirement specification and said, you know, if that worked good for elevators, it probably would work really good for rail cars. Rail cars, on average, about $4 million a car. You know, so you start buying 70, 80 cars, you're upwards approaching, you know, $250 million, $350 million you can spend on a vehicle order very, very quickly. And you want to get it right. So we developed our accessibility design requirement specification for vehicles. And in the hope of future vehicles would be the most accessible possible, with better spots for folks to sit that are using wheeled mobility devices, dual mode communications for folks who are deaf, people who are blind, all kinds of technology that will benefit, putting heaters in the right location so folks don't get burnt. Often the cleared out spaces with no seats that are the parking spaces for wheeled mobility devices become great places for designers of rail cars to put the heater. And then what happens? A person who has either limited sensitivity or none rolls up there, puts their feet on a 120, 130 degree device that's stainless steel and burns themselves. Folks say, well, wait a minute, 120, 130 degrees shouldn't burn you. Well, that's what happens with people with disabilities. But by having us involved and having this part of the settlement agreement, we now have an accessibility standard that says put it under the seats, put it in places where folks aren't going to touch it, and they're not going to get hurt. So once the system becomes more accessible and more people with disabilities are on the system, what do you do if there's an emergency? I mean, you guys, I'm sure, have heard of the fires. We had two fires last year, one on Green Line, one on Red Line. Well, what happens? How do people get out? What do you do if you have a derailment or an accident? We've had a couple of those, unfortunately. You had the major accident down in D.C. where I believe 11 people died. How do you get people with disabilities off of a rail car that is derailed and is in between two stations? What do you do? Well, in the past, what would happen is you would stay. So I would just sit there. Everybody else would leave. They would go down and go up a spiral staircase through a manhole cover and evacuate. If it's on fire, if it's smoky, if it's a dirty bomb situation or something like that, you're just hoping those first responders are track stars. And when they get there, they can figure out how to pick you up like a sack of Tatey's and get you out of there. But they're not going to be able to use this spiral staircase, so they're going to have a different path of travel. It may be another 1,000 foot down the track or something like that. So what we did is we looked at evacuation chairs were used at World Trade Center at 9/11. There were a few of these evacuation chairs that were actually used. There was a handful of folks with disabilities that did evacuate the building. It enabled, they were really designed originally for high-rise buildings for going down. They have a track system on the back, these little rubber tracks that hit the nosings on the stairs, and a very small 100-pound female could easily take me down 40 flights of stairs in an evacuation chair, no problem. But we had an issue where, well, wait a minute, we have subterranean stations. So often we have to go up. Well, those chairs are only designed to go down. So we did an exhaustive search. The chairs that I actually purchased for General Motors at the world headquarters for GM and then again at Disney for a bunch of the rides was the basic unit that went downstairs. We searched it and we found one that actually was designed to be able to go up as well. Had a 500-pound capacity, ergonomically designed for first responders so that the lead person that was in the front, the arms extend out, they're walking forward, they're not backwards, and they can get up a flight of stairs relatively quick. So we purchased 367 of them. They were on site in January of this year, and we started deploying them out to our rail cars so that we get, they're called married pairs, so you have two cars connected together, that's a married pair, and we'll have one evac chair on each married pair in the system. That's our goal. I believe we're there today with that. And then we developed policies around those chairs. How are they going to use them? But that only got us, so imagine now you've got this evacuation chair, the rail car falls off the, gets derailed, it's laying almost on its side or something, you're able to get a person into the evac chair and you can get them out of the car, you're now down on the track bed. Okay, well they still got to carry you, everybody else is out, thanking God that they got out of the tunnel, person with a disability is still back there, now what do you do? We had a couple folks at the T that had seen these electric carts, and the carts were used to shuttle first responders from a safe zone down the rail to the area where the problem was. And the idea was they would bring the first responders to the car, they could load it up with all their gear, and they could put stretchers, the backboards, the baskets, things like that on it. Well, we looked at it and said, well, back to the funding stream for a second, if the MBTA is going to buy these, use these to get folks out of the tunnel and to bring first responders in, then we believe there has to be some accessibility built into those. So we designed a securement system that would accept the evacuation chair. So first responders could pick the evacuation chair up, put it on top of the cart, secure it in place, and go 10 miles an hour down the rails to get you out. We just had our first concept test of this at the Alewife, between the Alewife station and the next station. Cambridge Fire was the lead first responder group, and it was a huge success. I showed the video at FEMA in DC just a few weeks back, and also at Chicago Transit Authority and the mayor's office in Chicago, and folks around the country are starting to see what we're doing here. on emergency evacuation and emergency egress. And it's just very exciting. If you can get folks out, I mean, that's a huge win, right? If you can get folks out and everybody gets to get out at about the same time where they're not just sitting and waiting, those are huge benefits. You also have to effectively communicate with people. Ensure equal access to information that's provided by the MBTA. It's not fair for us just to bang something audibly, and a person who's deaf is standing there. They don't know that the train was delayed. They don't know that you shifted over to a different track. They didn't get any of that. It benefits all customers when we do things in dual mode. That's what we call it, as dual mode, both audibly and visually. It's just such a wonderful technology to leverage that technology to better communicate with your customers. So it's in vehicles, in stations, at bus stops. We're rolling out tactile braille signage used to supplement the standard visual signage. We're doing that both at stations and at bus stops. So for the first time, a blind individual will be able to navigate through a station and know where they're going with tactile braille. And they'll be able to do the same thing at a bus stop, where they can come up and know that that's the 44 and it's, here's its terminus, that's where it's going. And if they want more information, here's the website or phone number and stuff like that. All the information that everybody, by the way, visually has been getting for years. Website accessibility enhancements. It's an extension of your effective communication. Kind of getting the word out about our fixed route accessibility. All the things that we've changed, all the things that we've enhanced. We've got our new accessibility at the T. We're launching the access guide. I had a meeting yesterday with the general manager. We're planning to launch this, I believe, the second week of November. So I would encourage you to go onto our website and check it out. It was designed by a person who's blind. He's done everything on this. This is so accessible. It's so exciting because it works with screen readers and everything else. And Larry Hale, the designer that's working on it, the other thing that he's done for me is really help teach the MBTA and MassDOT that a person who's blind can be a lead designer on a website development program. And I don't have to worry about it being accessible because he had to use accessible tools to design it. And it's a great lesson. As I mentioned earlier on the reduced fare offices and how that was brought into our activity, this covers all the eligible customers that ride our buses, trains, subway, water ferries. We have our transportation access pass. We have about 40,000 cards that are issued. We have 155,000 senior cards. We have 6,000 blind access cards. I find that amazing. We are a very difficult and complex system. We have 6,000 people who are blind that are using our system, most of them every day, figuring out how to do it so they can stay independent, go to school, go to work, and have that bite of the apple. Reduce fares with improving fixed route access, an increasingly attractive travel option for users of our paratransit system. If you guys do any research on this subject, what you'll find is paratransit is breaking the bank at every transit agency around the nation. Why? Because we didn't follow all those laws that we mentioned earlier in the presentation. We never fixed anything on the fixed route side and ensured that it was accessible, and we just took that whole segment of the population and slid them over to paratransit. And now we're crying because paratransit is too expensive. Well, one of our goals is, okay, well, let me tell you what we've done on fixed route. Let me reintroduce fixed route to you with all these tools, be able to communicate with you. You can wayfind. The elevators are working. The system works. Come on back and give us a try. One, I wanted to mention it's not just that we were sued, we settled, all of a sudden the T said in that one really nice sentence, gee whiz, we want to be the best. I mean, that's a start. But we also, I have the most incredible guy, Judge Patrick King is a retired Superior Court Justice from the Commonwealth. He is my federal court-appointed independent monitor over our settlement agreement. So when there's disputes, Judge King gets involved, and we win. We being really the T and people with disabilities. But imagine how many budget issues come up where people think they can do something less than what we should be doing. It's just such a wonderful tool to have a settlement agreement and an independent monitor that can say, no way. I went out and I looked at all that. I looked at the settlement agreement. I looked at what you guys are trying to do. That's not going to meet the terms of the settlement agreement. You've got to listen to Gary and his staff, and you're going to have to do more. He also oversees the external monitoring program. The plaintiffs wrote this into the settlement agreement. So we do an independent third-party analysis of our system. How accessible really is it? So we play a role in it, but it's an independent exercise, and then Judge King pays for that out of his budget that I pay him, and then he manages that whole process so it stays independent. Another key piece of the settlement agreement is, well, all these things are great, but if the T doesn't know what it's doing, if we don't know where we're at, things could fall through the cracks. So we had to create an internal compliance monitoring program for ourselves and then demonstrate back to Judge King and the court that we are testing our system. So I have 16 or 18 part-time monitors that go out and test the system. They're like a secret shopper deal. They go out and ride the system and evaluate all modes. They test everything that we do, and then we take that data and fold that back into our organization so that we know where the problem areas are and where we need to focus our energy. The customer complaint generated stuff. In the past, what the T would do, someone would call up and make a complaint. That would go often to a department and folks would just get on it. Somebody was rude, pull them in here, don't be rude again. There wasn't a lot of documentation. There wasn't a lot of follow-up. There wasn't a closed-loop system in place. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to take the complaint system and really put in place a closed-loop system. Use complaints as an opportunity to get better. If somebody took the time to complain, not in all cases, but in many, many cases, they've been wronged and you've got something you need to fix. And looking at those complaints as an opportunity to improve is completely different than what the T has ever looked at before, or how they've ever looked at those things before. So we've streamlined a bunch of stuff. We have our Office of Diversity and Civil Rights and Operations that we work closely with. And for the first time, we've taken customer complaints and employee complaints. And when it's a civil rights-based issue, our Office of Diversity and Civil Rights investigates. Prior to us, any customer-related civil rights case was not investigated by the MBTA. So imagine someone standing on the curb and they get driven by, and they believe they're driven by because they have a disability. The driver didn't want to pick them up. They try to complain about that, and they're like, sorry, we don't do that. We don't investigate those. So today we're investigating those, and we are disciplining folks when we find that happened. Oop. So moving forward, that's kind of a snapshot of present. We're going to continue to pursue the goal of making the T the global benchmark for accessible and inclusive public transportation. And I can't tell you how difficult it was to get the T to sign on to that statement. But it's one of those vision statements that can really lead an organization. Our current Secretary of Transportation and my general manager, Rich Davey, are so on board with this vision. I can't tell you how much fun it is. We influence and leverage both the capital investment plan. It's how you get money. It's how you tell the state of Massachusetts, here's where I need money and where I'm going to spend it. So we influence that. The TIP, or the Transportation Improvement Plan, is a longer range, 25-year plan. We're in the TIP now. We're able to influence that. So we're driving more dollars in. We're pursuing innovative strategies and technologies to further enhance accessibility. And then we'll continue our internal compliance and oversight and continue to work with the judge to help ensure accessibility is incorporated into the fabric of what we do. And with that, thank you. And I know that was a lot of information, and I apologize. I know it's early on a Saturday morning, but I...
It was good. It was excellent, Gary. I just like to fire a couple questions at everybody by the students. Anyone want to go?
Other major cities tried to contact you so they can start upgrading their systems as well?
Yeah, it's a great question. I'm very blessed. I still sit on the U.S. Access Board, and the U.S. Access Board is the federal agency that writes all the accessibility guidelines for the nation. And so because of my Access Board requirements, what I have to do for the board, and because of what we're doing at the T, we have had many, many systems reach out to us. New York, Chicago, WMATA down in D.C. So I think a lot of this stuff, especially with the emergency evacuation stuff, was one of those light bulb moments where when I showed it to he's an undersecretary for Secretary LaHood. He was just appointed. If you get a chance to Google this guy, he's amazing. His name's Richard DeVelder. He was born with no arms, no legs. He's a professional, well-educated, and what a spark plug. I mean, this guy's amazing. And he was working for Governor Schwarzenegger out in California, staunch Republican. And Secretary LaHood found out about him, and they offered him this new position that they created at Department of Transportation. It's a special advisor to Secretary LaHood. How do we get public transportation more accessible? So I met Richard at the 20th anniversary of the ADA at the White House. And we're both sitting there all excited. You know, I got to shake hands with the president and everything. And he's telling me, and I'd heard about him, I'd read about him, and he's telling me about his new position. I invited him to Boston. It was the first of his, he's calling it a listening tour. He's trying to go around and hit all the different transit agencies. He came here and spent a day and a half with us. And I mean, we gave him an education that is unbelievable. And the last thing we did was I showed the emergency evacuation video to him. And he saw that and he's like, oh my God, you got to bring this to D.C. And 2 weeks later was the FEMA conference down in D.C., or in Baltimore, actually. That conference, the title was Getting Real. When I read the title, I'm like, oh, God, this is federal government at its worst. You know, it's another one of these. We've been through this I've been through it for 30 years now, and I'd like to see something different. But what happened was, the Getting Real was, it was about FEMA planning for real. What happened in Katrina is we didn't plan for real. We planned for best case. And all of a sudden, the buses pulled up and there were no lifts and everybody's in wheelchairs and many of those folks died. And the whole idea was, how do you plan for real? So I showed the video at FEMA and you had representatives from all 50 states, many from transportation, highway departments, public transportation, that kind of thing. And we're getting all kinds of requests now for folks to find more information about the evacuation chairs that we selected and we're using, the carts, how we modified the carts, the securements we use. So it's a great question. I can tell you it makes you feel really good because it's not just a Boston thing. It really is a national thing.
Andy, I was going to ask you, do you still find today that a lot of complaints are coming in?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we still have. And that's a great question. I mean, we fixed all the stuff we should have been working on in the 70s. Really, to be honest with you, a lot of the stuff that we're doing really should have been done over the last 25, 30 years. So what we're getting today, the complaints are different today. Now it's more of I didn't get the service I should have gotten kind of thing versus some of the more egregious things that we saw. In 2007, probably our major complaint was, I'm a person who's blind, I'm at a bus stop, and the bus driver doesn't think that I can hear that the bus just drove by me. Which particularly egregious thing, right? I mean, I can't imagine someone would do that. But those were the kind of complaints we got, and we got a lot of them. Today, the complaints are different. We still have a lot of complaints because we still have a lot of work to do.
As Bostonites go forth across the country, and we interact with other systems and other populations across the country, can we be now proud of what we have in Boston in terms of 2010?
Boy, we should be very, very proud. I think, you know, this is a case where, and I'm not a huge fan of lawsuits, but this is a case where one needed to be filed. This was a settlement that needed to be hammered out. And we've gone from really worst in the nation to first in the nation in so many areas. I mean, our procedures that we use for bus operations, and we're taking that model and we're applying it to heavy rail, light rail, commuter boat, commuter rail, trackless trolleys, and bus rapid transit. So everything will be standardized. those procedures don't exist anywhere else in the world. And a funny story around that, as far as can we be proud, when I left Disney, it was the last thing I did at Disney was redo all the bus procedures. It was the first thing I did here. I got a call just a couple months ago from a friend of mine, a director at Disney, and he goes, Gary, you guys are a public agency, right? I said, yeah. He says, well, can I request those procedures back? Because I know you took what you had here, and I know you made them better. I'd like to bring them back to Disney and use them here. And because we're a public agency, we can't have private documents because we use federal money. We use the people's money. So I'm like, sure, absolutely. So not only are we providing information to other transit agencies, but they're now going to be using those procedures or a version of those procedures back at Disney again. So yeah, we should be very, very proud. I mean, we're leading the nation in emergency evacuation and developing something that's logical, that works. I mean, rather than just saying we can't do anything, we're finding solutions. We have to, because the settlement tells us we have to.
And you're getting the feel from the disability community that we've taken giant steps.
Yes.
And they, in fact, are working in conjunction with what your department is trying to do.
Yeah, it's
so it's no longer confrontational, but more or less supportive of each other.
Yeah, it's such a great point. I mean, everything that we've done with the assistance of the people that sued us. I mean, they're our best partners. They're our toughest critics. They know when it's right. They know when it's wrong. And they have just been wonderful to tell us, man, you guys have transformed the system. We know it's a better system. And one of my fears is we are so much better than we were just three and a half years ago. But boy, we've got a long ways to go. And the more we rest on where we are today, the harder it's going to be to take that next step. Sometimes a step function, when you're down here, coming up to here is the easiest thing you'll do. It's that steady climb that's very difficult, or maintaining where you are becomes very, very difficult over time.
For the time we have left, I'm going to turn it over to Robin to bring closure today, okay?
I just wanted to thank you for coming today, and we're going to honor you with a CBDC t-shirt.
Oh, wow, thank you, you guys. Thank you very much.